Okay, now President Marcos Jr., considering that it's a very different foreign policy, right? Coming from the former President Duterte, in his speech, he was quite direct and clear when he said illegal, coercive, aggressive, and deceptive actions continue to violate our sovereignty, sovereign rights, and jurisdictions. So the question now is, this language, although it's refreshing in terms of standing up for the victory, the arbitral ruling, does this affect the relationship we have, the relationship of both countries? Because there's more at stake here. The West Philippine Sea is one thing, but China is also the largest trading partner. China is our neighbor at the end of the day. When it comes to even our culture, there are many Filipino-Chinese individuals in the Philippines, right? We trade with China the most. So this kind of language, does this help?
Well, in a way, this kinds of language, calling out, you could even say naming, and the Transparency Initiative in the South China Sea have, of course, some have called it a name and shame campaign. But we, the Philippines under Marcos, are not doing anything. It's not, and it's not creating something out of nothing. If there is Chinese illegal and intrusive behavior, it's obvious with empirical evidence. You see videos, you see a very brave media covering the RORE missions. But I agree, China policy under Marcos Jr., and he states that the Philippines and other small powers should not be forced to choose. And the ability to be rational and to be sober in focusing on the issues that need to be managed, like the South China Sea, and not to put a lot of non-rational factors like emotions to somehow cause I'll say it, like Sinophobia, that we're seeing a little bit. That deprives us of a rational, coherent foreign policy if we just, negate and negatively attribute anything that is Chinese. It's more difficult for us as a Philippine society because we're not really a heterogeneous population. In other Southeast Asian countries, you could clearly see who have Chinese heritage or not. In the Philippines, we're all mixed, and if there's an anti-Chinese narrative and campaign, it's gonna hit a lot of those that should not be hit, unfortunately.
Okay. Now, China reportedly, well, they passed a domestic law to allow its coast guard to detain what they call trespassers in what they consider their maritime territory, which, by the way, their maritime territory, which they consider, it actually covers the exclusive economic zone of the Philippines. So that's what China considers its maritime territory. So, of course, the president in the speech said that this was worrisome. But how should the Philippines behave, right? With this domestic law, how can the Philippines push back? What should it do?
Right. I think it's important, and I think President Marcos alluded to this, that domestic maritime law should always coincide with international law. And this is not an option for us in the Philippines because this is stated in our constitution that our laws are governed by international laws and norms. And therefore, for example, the Maritime Zones Bill that he mentioned in his speech, that is, he said he's about to sign. It would have been great if it was already done and that law was passed. But I'm positive that that law will be passed anytime soon. That Maritime Zones Bill is based on international law, based on UNCLOS, based on the arbitral ruling in 2016. Unfortunately for China, despite being a signatory of UNCLOS and other international laws, has not used it as a basis of its domestic law. So, for example, this new law that it will unilaterally pass, I think it's quite dangerous. And while the Philippines may vehemently oppose it, I hope that other countries, neighboring countries, those that have also claims in the South China Sea would also speak up so that it doesn't come to the event that we're the only ones speaking up, and therefore the silence of other Southeast Asian claimants may mean that they're accommodating such an illegal law if we rely on international law.
Yeah. Now, how can the Philippines maximize the foreign foreign policy of President Marcos Jr.? So this is 6 years, right? The president has strengthened our relationship with the United States. This transparency initiative has brought more Western allies and more allies to speak on China's aggressive behavior. But we shouldn't just make this last 6 years. What's difficult in the Philippines is if another candidate wins who's very pro-China or would have the same foreign policy as that of Duterte, we're back to square one. And that's the problem that we have really in the country, because our policies are so personality driven, right?
That's correct, Karen. You basically summarize Philippine policy making. Indeed, it is personalized. And in fact, this is the apprehension of some of our neighboring countries. And some of my conversations, they would say, oh, here's the Philippines again with a different policy. What if in several years you'll change your mind? How can we invest and how can we collaborate with you if you keep changing your minds? The pendulum keeps on shifting from one side to the other. And painful as it may sound, it's true. So I think the best thing that the Marcos Jr. administration can do is to institutionalize through law, through legislation, through building institutions that could not be simply undermined by executive fiat, that will be somehow, but something that will also be consensual. No, it's important that what is clear here is that wala pong politika na domestic pagdating sa national security, no? Wala po dapat tayong kampo. Dito talaga dapat may unity because the national interest is at stake. Mm-hmm. So therefore, if there are politicians that refuse to protect and promote our national interest, then maybe they should think twice before running for office, because that is a severe dereliction of duty if you don't defend and promote and protect the national security and the strategic interest of the country that you are supposed to serve.
All right, now let me ask you another question. Okay, and now we know that the Ukrainian President Zelensky is in the Philippines. Can we show the photos already? He is in Malacañang this morning for a meeting with President Marcos Jr. Now, the Ukrainian leader is planning to invite Marcos Jr. to attend a peace summit this June, hosted by Switzerland. Zelensky was in Singapore over the weekend for the Shangri-La Dialogue as well, where Marcos delivered a keynote speech. Zelensky reportedly wanted to meet with Marcos Jr. in Singapore, but the Philippine leader flew back to Manila Friday night, while Zelensky arrived in Singapore June 1st. So Zelensky is drumming up support for Ukraine from Asian countries as it faces Russia's continuing onslaught. So what kind of dialogue and partnership do you believe should the Philippines offer or give to Zelensky? I mean, we do have trade with Russia. We are dependent at this point somehow. Go on.
We do. I think it's very interesting that Zelensky will make this trip, and this was not pre-announced, and in fact, if better coordinated, they could have both leaders could have met on the sidelines of the Shangri-La Dialogue. But even Zelensky's appearance in the Shangri-La Dialogue was also last minute, and it was of course well received. I think Zelensky knows that the Philippines have had quite cordial relations with Russia in the previous administration. And I think this is why he wanted to meet Marcos. If you notice, Zelensky, I don't know if Zelensky is visiting other Southeast Asian countries with the exception of Singapore and the Philippines, but I think the Ukrainian government knows that the Philippines perhaps still or maybe used to have a pro-Russian slant, and we observe that with the former president and even during the campaign in the 2022 election. So what could the Philippines offer? I think the speech of President Marcos lays it out. The Philippines does not want war. It is a country that pursues peace. Its actions to promote its national interests is never to instigate any form of aggression, despite the narratives that we hear from social media. And I think this meeting is not that. I'm looking at social media. They're even saying that, oh, Marcos might be the Zelensky of Asia. That's totally unfair. Mm-hmm. First and foremost, because we don't want war anywhere in the world, not just on our neighborhood. So I think there's convergence of interest in ensuring that there should be sustainable and long-lasting peace in that region where Ukraine is, because after all, that invasion continues to affect us in more ways than one.
On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today, Aris. I do hope to speak with you again. Political science professor Aris Arugay, thank you.
Thank you, Karen.